real quick, I'm just gonna kind of go over the agenda and I'll sort of manage the handoff. We have lots of different presenters today. Various folks from around IS&T have graciously granted their time to sort of tell you a little bit about what's been going on for the past several months. And yeah, so without further ado, we'll get started. There's my slide. Thank you very much. All right. So now that we've done through the welcome, as always, we're gonna introduce the new staff who have joined IS&T since the last all IS&T staff meeting. We're gonna do it a little bit differently though. We actually have a video for just about all of them. So this way you can sort of not just see their face and wave, but they're actually gonna just give a quick intro of where they are, who they're working with, what they're focused on, that sort of thing. Then we'll have an update on the internship program, which many of you have probably heard about, but might not know a whole lot about. Jill is gonna be presenting on that. Then Craig Hager and his team are going to be talking a little bit about the core network upgrades, which were going on heavily over the summer and wrapping up at the end of the summer. Rick Tyler has offered to talk about Web Help Desk. Most of you probably know that went live this Wednesday, but he's going to kind of go over some of the specifics of that. And then Plan IT, Plan IT, this is the Art Side Planner. And Jason Clevenger actually couldn't make it, but again, we have a video for this, and Steve Weston will talk a little bit more about that. And then Barb Braun has graciously agreed to give us a little recap of the move-in, which happened in August. And then our own Marcia Cope will wrap us up here. All right. So we have the new staff introductions. And I'm going to tab on over to this movie that we have here.
So my name is Christina Benedict. I'm working for Jim Deutschman and Mark Faraday, William Kalbreyer, and Ben Dvorak. I'm part of the U8 team. And I support the pre-application currently and some other smaller projects right now as I get up to speed. I'm mostly focused on .NET technologies. I know a bit of SQL, and that's really my area of focus right now.
Hi, I'm Chris Freeland. I'm the Senior Director of University Academic Computing, working with Denise Hirschbeck. Some of my main priorities right now are a rewrite of the undergraduate admission systems and new opportunities around student technologies and student technology services.
Hi, my name is Chris Wedge. I work for John Barton in NSS, and I'm responsible for Unified Communications.
Hi, my name is Stephen Huang. My supervisor is Ted Hines. I'm with the application development and support team. The projects I work on are mobile meal points, WebFact roster, Blackboard eGrades, 25 live reports, and the new course registration. Before coming to WashU, I work for Thomson Reuters. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mary Kupenhofer, and I work directly for Jessica Brock, and I work in the SharePoint group in web development. I supervise the back-end developers. Anything to do with InfoPath forms or any kind of special code development. Previously, I worked for MEMC out in St. Peter's, programming the robots that work the line developing silicon wafers. So that's where I come from. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Alex Netherton. I work under Brian Lawton. I'm on the FIS team, and I am working on a project to put the SIS reporting data into a data warehouse.
My name is Daniel Oakes. I am working with Craig Luciano on the PCSS field support team, and I primarily support facilities and undergraduate admissions with several other minor departments in there as well.
Hi, I'm Don Peterson. I work for IS&T under Rob Schmidt, and I'm a SharePoint developer, and right now I'm doing a lot of stuff in InfoPath and SharePoint front end.
I am Angelia Piper. I report to Marcia Koch. I am an administrative assistant for the IS&T department. I do calendar and meeting management, as well as a variety of administrative support functions.
My name's Jerry Rothler. I work with PCSS. My supervisor's Craig Luciano. I support the DUC, the athletic complex, some South 40 sites. I came here from a Fortune 1000 company, Synveo. They were a printer. And before that, I also worked for BJC as desktop support, supporting the Learning Center and the Meridian complex right down the street.
For those of you who will just stand up real quick. And also, I wanted to mention, we didn't have a video for her, but Gwen Arthur, if I'm not mistaken, is one that we didn't. If she's here, again, I can stand as well. Very hard, Gwen. Thank you all very much. I'm going to hand it over to Gilles for an update on the internship program, and he'll talk to you a little bit about that.
Thank you, Jeff. Good morning, everybody. So thank you for being here today. I'm delighted to be here and to introduce the internship program for expanding diversity in technology. With this presentation, which should last 5 minutes, I'm going to, explain to you what is this internship and, going through with details. Oh, I forgot something. So this program is under the direction of Dennis Hirschbeck, and so my name is Gilles Iwad, and I've been also the supervisor for this internship since May 2012. So what is the Diversity Inclusion Grant? So the Diversity and Inclusion Grant is a project from the Office of Provost to improve the university environment for women and members of underrepresented minority groups. So 8 grants for a total of $174,000 have been allocated this year. And IS&T was awarded $30,000, and IS&T has also provided matching funds for the project budget. The funding has permitted to set up a technology environment, the intern wages, as well as the training curriculum. So, this internship aimed to reach 4 goals to cover Washington University diversity and inclusion efforts. We wanted to provide people from different backgrounds with an opportunity to learn web technology, because we all know that entering the technology field is not an easy task. And we wanted also to attract people of great ability from all types of backgrounds to increase the proportion of women and underrepresented employees. And finally, the idea was to transition interns to full-time employment and to have working-ready personnel to work on university projects. So about the recruitment, we have nearly 60 applicants who sent us an application. 47 applicants responded to invitation to complete 2 tests. So we had the BAPT test, stands for Burger Aptitude Programming Test. So this test is used to identify candidates with the aptitude to learn programming skills. The Windows test was a simple test to assess the candidate's knowledge about Microsoft XP. So based on the score of the testing, 22 applicants were selected for the interview. We have chosen 10 candidates, 4 were alternates in case of someone decided to withdraw. Alright, so about the internship. The internship started in June 11th of this year and will end on November 21st, just before Thanksgiving. The intern have spent an average of, so it's 40 weeks commitment, and they spend an average of 20 hours a week. And most of them have seen their working and time expanded when needed. During the first 3 months of this internship, the interns and myself have attended over 10 classes at the University of Missouri to learn most of the hot web technologies, as SharePoint, CSS, Tree, HTML5, InfoPath, JavaScript, and so on. The interns were compensated for their time to learn and gain skill and knowledge. And finally, after the training period, everyone had the opportunity to put the newly acquired skill into practice. So we did, basically right now we have people doing content migration, we have also people working on migrating the STS website from Joomla to SharePoint 2010. We have people who now are working with developing SQL-based or also working on .NET. So we, as I told you, we have selected 10 people from different backgrounds with little or no prior experience in technology. From the 10 people selected, two were immediately placed on a full-time position. There are two women with a background in technology who wish to return the workforce after raising their children. Two people also withdraw for personal reasons. The six current interns had no previous exposure to technology career before entering the program. They represent diversity of age, ethnicity, gender, race, and geographics. And after this slide, you should watch a short video introducing them to you. And their names are Ameda, Chase, Dynik, Greg, Michael, and Juana. And I think I see Chase somewhere, maybe somewhere else. Chase, can you stand up, please?
Hi, my name is Dianique Brooks. I'm one of the interns here at the Web Development Program at IS&T at Washington University. I work in content and development, and I develop all the different sites as they come along for all the new clients. And quality assurance is my specialty.
Salutations, everyone. My name is Chase Callahan, and I've been graced with the opportunity to take an internship here in web development. My tasks have focused mainly on the responsibilities of the client side, along with the design of the new STS website. And I also enjoy long walks on beaches.
Hi, my name is Greg Grimes. I'm currently a web development intern here at IS&T, and I work on a team tasked with migrating the STS website from Joomla to SharePoint. And my focus has been on migrating the forms and functionalities of the site.
Hi, my name is Juana Jackson, and I'm one of the web development interns here at WashU. I am currently working with STS, maintaining and updating the Residence Life website.
I'm Michael Mork, and I am working with STS on their mobile initiative for the university, which includes making updates to existing applications through their iTunes App Store on Xcode, as well as working on our web responsive presence, which includes working on the responsive SharePoint template for a prototype STS site.
My name is Armita Nichols. I am currently working as an intern with the Web Development Internship Program in IS&T. I am hoping to be able to continue to learn as much as possible. I am going to school for computer science, so this has been very beneficial for me in that I am able to kind of explore the different aspects and avenues of my degree field. I'm hoping to stay with WashU and possibly go into more of the networking aspect of my career field and, if possible, be able to contribute in that way.
That's it for the videos. So I just would like to thank you very much for being here this morning. And I would like also to thank Denis Hirschbeck as well as the steering committee for making this internship possible and a great experience. You gave the intern the opportunity to be successful and have a bright future. So thank you very much. And thank you again for being here today.
Without further ado, we will ask Craig and his team to come on up. As promised, they're going to talk a little bit about the core network upgrade. And so, Craig.
Good morning. We're kind of taking a little different approach on this. We kicked off our project a few years ago regarding the core upgrade. And instead of one person speaking, we're going to let the entire team take portions of this presentation and move forward. So, the part that I'm going to be covering is the funding requirements and vendor evaluation selection. We kicked off this project 2 years ago to look at what it would take to replace the core. There were two key factors in looking at this. One is the existing core is 8 to 10 years old. The Cisco current hardware, goes end of life in November of 2012. So that was a timeline that we had to address quickly. And then also to continue to meet the current capacity, bandwidth capacity requirements at the university. So along this process, we looked at all the existing infrastructure that we have. There's four core devices throughout the campus. Brookings, Siegel, Med School, Commodity, and the South 40. So in looking at all these different locations, we identified what budget, what it would cost to replace this hardware. And then from that aspect, we took the funding budget, met with Andy and the administration group to see, okay, how can we fund this large of a project? The core is what supports the entire university campus, just not schools or departments. It's the entire core. It's our connection to the internet. It's our connection to the internet, I2, along with the med school as well. So it's the entire core campus. Through the funding process, we identified the funding mechanisms, and we brought in, at that time, we looked at all the requirements. We set up several requirements meetings with all the different schools and departments across campus. There was probably a half a dozen meetings over a four-month period where we listened to the school IT directors to really understand what technologies we have today and what new technologies in the future that we need to support. So as part of those discussions, we developed a requirements document to move forward. As part of that, we looked at what are the top three competitors or top three vendors that we should look at as far as supplying these core services. We used Gartner as well, look at the magic quadrant to kind of see where they all fit in. And the three that really stood out to us was Juniper, HP, and Cisco. And after many months of evaluation equipment, looking at design discussions, pricing, and so forth, Cisco was the vendor of choice that we decided to go with. So as we went through the process, Cisco spent many days and weeks kind of putting different designs together and seeing what would fit best for the university. So once Cisco was picked, we then developed the timeline of the installation. All the equipment was procured and purchased in the December-January timeframe, December of 2011 to January of 2012, and equipment was ordered and equipment showed up approximately the March timeframe. So once all the equipment showed up, we had a very short time span. Actually, we want to get this in during the course of the summer, so that way we don't impact major services in the movement of all the students come August. So with further ado, I'm going to now turn it over to John, where he's going to kind of go over some of the bill of materials and the next steps.
So as Craig said, we selected Cisco as the vendor, and the next step was, this was in January, generating the bill of materials. So we made an effort to account for all the modules, all the SFPs, all the switches that we were going to need. And then we tried to make an inventory of all the existing equipment, see what could be repurposed, and then put together an order so that we could put in the new equipment, pull out the old equipment, reuse the old equipment in an order that worked where nothing was down. So this was the final effort in putting together the bill of materials. The first place where we actually implemented was at spring break. It was actually the South 40. The core switch for the South 40 was one of the switches was going end of life. This was one of the more straightforwards. It was just a one-for-one swap. Actually, this time the old switch is still there below it, so you can see we just had to swap it out. But we got out all the end of life line cards, cleaned everything up, moved everything over. Then we began preparations for June 2nd. We moved to the data center. This was not a switch replacement. The data center switch was not end of life, but we incorporated a redundant switch. So everything was connected to this one switch. We added a second, and this gives you some feel for the redundancy. So at this point, we have two core switches, two firewalls, two load balancers, and everything's redundant to the core. So this takes us up to June 2nd. And this is the data center rack. You can see the Nexus 7000. This is the new switch all the way over here to the left. So all that was, all those cables were run, all that was added. That takes us through June, and I'll hand it over to Jason.
So this brings us to downtown. So you can see the main campuses, we got, you know, all this, but you may not know, we also have facilities in downtown St. Louis at 900 Walnut. All of the internet connectivity for WashU is done in 900 Walnut. We have, next slide here. Two routers in downtown, the commodity router and the SLIAC router. This router is for internet too. This one is for all the commodity internet traffic. This is also our backup link. If we lose connectivity to I1, our internet one, we fail back to that. So the key points are we've got two 10 gig links from downtown that come back to two separate feeds on campus. We've got one gig link to internet one. This is the per 2 gig link to internet one. That's our primary link. We've got a backup link to level 3, which gives us an additional 1 gig capacity if the cogent link dies. And we have a 1 gig link up to the Indiana Gigapod in Indiana. That gives us all of our internet 2 connectivity. The way we were able to make this transition work is, this is the original equipment that we had in there before, a little bit messy. We pulled all of the gear out of there. As you know, when we did this maintenance, there was no outage to Internet 1 or Internet 2 connectivity during that maintenance period. And we were able to do that by sliding the switch out of the rack while it was live. All the connections are still plugged in, everything's still powered on. We pulled it out, set it up on that cart there. Everything kept working during the entire maintenance. Once we were done, we slid it back in. We added the new Nexus gear that we've got down here, so that's the new router that we replaced. Failed everything back that was up that we had failed over here, failed it all back to there, and pretty much no outage at all to any of the internet connectivity to campus. After that, we moved to the med school. We replaced the router at the med school. This was, again, a really easy and straightforward thing. You can see there's not many connections to the med school router. We've basically got two main connections. One goes to the entire med school campus, and the other one goes to one of the smaller departments within there, radiology. All of them are connected through 10 gig links, and one of the key points is radiology and the engineering school are two academic departments that have 10 gig links to each other. And the key is that they've got a high-performance computing setup that they want to do. Half of it's over in the med school, half of it's in the engineering school. So we have two departments that actually have full 10 gig links to each other from med all the way through the core to the Danforth campus. That's it for me. Thank you, Jason.
So to minimize the, you know, the outage, we placed the new Nexus cores and EPS and Siegel, so there's a lot of prior work that needed to be done, and Jared Braun, Justin Nickert, and Gary Benning pre-ran all of our fiber connections that we needed between those, and there was a lot of fiber verification that needed to be done prior to that, and probably all in all they have like 2 solid weeks of just fiber verification, so they put a lot of time and effort into it, and we very much appreciate that. Also part of the new Nexus, we needed to increase the power to them, so we had to go up to 220 volt to be able to handle the power that they needed. Let's see. So this is EPS, this is where the, or this is Siegel, this is where the Siegel core is located at. And this one was a little simpler than the EPS one. Off to the right here is where the old existing core was, but we had to move all the connections out of that one and into this new one, and to minimize the downtime, we reran all the new fiber patch cables up and over to the other fiber racks. So probably there's a couple days worth of just pre-running and labeling on fiber, so we knew exactly where all the connections were. So the time we went to go cut over, it was a very minimal downtime for each department. Then this one took a little bit more work because we're physically moving from the Brookings building. We moved it down to EPS. So we had to extend all the fiber connections that ran into Brookings down to EPS. And it shows there with the new Siegel core there, or the EPS core there. So kind of the same concept. We pre-ran all the fibers. So that morning when we went to go cut over, everything was pre-ran. We just had our plug in and extend it out to the building where it ran. All in all, between the two places, we have 115 different connections we had to run. There's about 50 in EPS here, and there's about 65 in Siegel. The reason why we moved it down to EPS was it's a lot better room. There's plenty of power here, and there's actually dedicated cooling to this room. It's actually a true TR.
I believe that's it. Thank you, Jason. This is kind of the heart of our network.
EPS and Siegel, as Jason pointed out. This shows you basically the planning diagram as where we started. It looks very busy. The key points to take away, though, is the level of redundancy that we now have built in. Many departments are dual home to us. West Campus is one of them. So at any point in our network fails or the fiber fails, we are very confident that we can maintain connectivity. One of the biggest changes with the Nexus line from what we had before is our ability to partition out the actual hardware into different VDCs, they're called. And what that allowed us to do was move away from our original collapsed core design where distribution and routing was done all in the same actual switch gear into different VDCs. It's a much cleaner setup, and it allowed us to kind of rethink how everything was set up. The hardest part about this was doing the cleanup. As you can imagine, taking lines of configuration out of your core network is a little intimidating. So when we were setting up the new devices, we got to go through and really clean out our existing configuration. And the biggest part of that was actually the two ASAs. We have two brand new firewalls. They're active in standby. They're fully redundant. And our NOC technician, Andrew Stegman, was responsible for going through and cleaning all of the access lists. And we have roughly 100,000 lines that he went through, and most of it was ported over, but he did a very good job of cleaning through, and anything that didn't need to be there came out. And roughly, I'd say half of the university is behind a firewall. One of the biggest changes for this is our ASA capacity. So before, we only had licenses for 20 different groups, we'll call them. Now we're up to 50. We got to do a bit of organizing and put departments together that made more sense together and allowed us to really boil down the rules that we had. Also, everything is now IPv6 enabled in our core. Kind of the next step is the IPv4 addresses are getting very close to running out. Also, the firewalls went from a 5 gig throughput to a 10 gig throughput maximum. And within our core, as we said before, since it feeds pretty much everyone, we had roughly 250 networks that we had to go through and make sure were set up correctly and rebuild on the new Nexus configuration words from the old Cisco 65.9 language. And as I said before, this says 10,000 firewall lines, but I assure you there's more. So the new core features we have, we mentioned the VDCs, but the next big one is Fabric Path. One of the protocols we use, which is keeps loops from happening on our network, is called spanning tree. And what Fabric Path has allowed us to do is not just keep the loops from within our core, but allow us to manage those layer two networks down a level. So we don't have to, with all the people that are redundantly connected to us, plan out the spanning tree instances across our actual distribution design. We can manage those instances kind of directly interfacing with the customer. And now here's Jim.
So a quick mention to the next steps. Joe mentioned fabric, or I stopped on there, bandwidth capacity. So we have much more capacity than we had before. So we're working to get the word out and to make sure people know that capacity is there. Things that they might not be able to do before, maybe they can. So we want to start filling this bandwidth up with useful traffic. We also, Joe mentioned Fabric Path. We think that has possibilities to change the sort of recommended design. So for years, Cisco's recommendation has been you want to route as close to the edge as you can. That removes some flexibility and makes us reluctant to do some things that our customers want us to do. So we're working with Cisco now to see if Fabric Path can be used to create a distribution layer that allows us to push the VLANs out where they need to go without making any compromises to stability or uptime. Firewall VLAN consolidation. With the new ASAs, we have much more capacity on the core, so there's a lot of one-off firewalls out there. We'd like to bring those into the core where we can. We're also looking to improve monitoring. And so the final thing I guess I'd like to say is there's a lot of people to be thanked. There was a lot of work involved in this. So all the people who presented here contributed a lot of hours over the summer, a lot of weekends, a lot of very early mornings, as well as the people mentioned in the presentation. So Jared and Gary and Justin, not mentioned were Nathan Litz and
Chris Fudge, Chad Minders. So this is a relatively small group. While this work was going on, somebody had to keep the phones getting answered, and there were normal summer projects going on. And I think two more groups to be thanked. One is everybody in IS&T. I think there's a lot of people we work with where we had to prioritize this at the top of the list at some points in the summer. And we got a lot of flexibility to let other things slip where we could to make this sure this stayed on track. And then to the other departments, we had a lot of people who contributed requirements. And then when it came time to make the final cutover, up until the end of July, this happened pretty much without incident. When we got to the end of July, we knew we had to make the final cut. We could have moved things over one at a time, but it was going to make things stretch into the school year, and we'd risk having an impact to the students. So we got everything together and made the cut at the end of July, and we had a lot of help from people in this room and out of the schools to help us troubleshoot, work out any problems that arose, and get things squared away in time that we had a stable network when the students returned.
Next up, we have Rick Tyler, and he's going to be speaking about Web Help Desk. Rick, take it away.
While he's doing that, I wanted to mention also, it goes without saying, Craig Hager deserves a big round of applause. He pulled off everything his team just talked to you about, while also having people leave his team, transition into his team. Every time I woke up in the morning, I would see another email from his team going out at 6 o'clock in the morning saying, we just completed this successfully. So let's please recognize Craig. Hager. Bear with me here for a minute.
I didn't realize you were
in training. Yeah, that's I'm a little sleepy these days, so... So about last year, this time, we kicked off a project to replace the Altiris help desk system. And Josh Lawrence, our project manager, started meeting with two teams. Because what was actually going on, IS&T kept hearing about this thing called, we're going to replace Altiris. But other teams were hearing stuff like, hey, can we get you to also use this system that we're going to replace Altiris with? And so Josh started meeting with two groups of people. He met with IS&T people and said, hey, what do you need when we go to replace the system? And then he met with people from the School of Engineering, the Brown School, the Business School, and also the, is that it, Josh?
Library.
Oh, library. Thank you, Josh. And he invited Sam Fox in law and also the med school, but they decided to participate but just as part of the steering committee and not to actually use the product right now. So Josh had a couple different things, groups he was meeting with. And during that time, he was gathering a bunch of requirements. And so what I'm going to show you here in a few minutes is what we ended up launching yesterday, which is actually the very tactical replacement of Altiris. What you have to understand to appreciate this system and where we're trying to go is that it's in a broader context. It's in a context of trying to achieve for customers across campus a consistent look and feel when you submit a service request. And that's very important, okay? Because basically, up until Wednesday, at least on the Danforth campus, if you were a customer, you went to Arts and Sciences, and you wanted to submit a service request, you did it with their system. And if you went to the B school, you did it with their system. And if you went to the Brown school, you did it with their system. Okay. And then if you had to ask somebody in Central IT how you had to do it with our system. But as of yesterday, at least on the Danforth campus, for core schools, we're all now using the same system. And that is a huge thing for someone like me, who's trying to get people to work together in consistent teams. And so that's something in the background that we've been working on since last October. And so I'm very, very proud of that. Tactically, though, we do have this system that we launched yesterday. And I want to put it in a context for you. I want to start off not with your perspective of the system, but with the customer's perspective of the system. Okay? You may never actually log into this interface. A few of you have because you messed up your login IDs. And so when you went to log in, this is what you saw. But you can log into the system as a customer, okay? And what you do when you do that, this person, Rick Cottmell, that's my real name actually, is Rick Cottmell, is actually a student account. And when students log in, they have the ability to submit service requests to any number of different units. Now, just because Law and Sam Fox and the med school aren't using the system, we want to remind them that they are still a part of our community. So if somebody goes out there to use it, you just say, hey, they're not using it right now, you can go to their website, or you can email them, or you can call them, okay? But as a student, we want you to know that you're still a part of our community, so go ahead and submit something, we'll just close it and let them know about it, okay? The one I really want to point out, though, is the power of this system being used by the Brown School, which I think is very interesting. When you think about the system, you may think of it from a technology perspective. Yeah, people go out there and they submit email requests, or they submit a request for VPN, that kind of thing. But the reality is, it's just a ticketing system, right? It's a way to take requests from a customer. And so the Brown School fully embraced that on day one, and they actually have everything in their school being submitted through this system that makes sense to them. So if they're in event support, their faculty, staff, and students can go out there and submit event support requests. If they are somebody like an adjunct faculty member and they have a light bulb out there in their classroom or something, they submit a facilities request in the system. You can see all the different facility requests that are in there. If they are a person who needs photocopying or they need some type of assistance at the administrative, I'm sorry, that's technology right there. Call it their service center. And they need some assistance with things like photocopying or faxing their labels, so they can actually submit it this way too. So I don't know if it'll pick up steam over the next year and a half, 2 years. My hope is that this system, from a customer's view, will start to be voiced about, hey, why can't I submit a request for HR request through this system, right? If I have some kind of question just to the HR department, why can't I submit a request to facilities through this system? Or something like it, okay? So it's simply a ticketing system that would allow a customer to submit requests, and then also, once they submit them, to track those requests. And so they can go out here and see all their active requests, all their closed requests, they can cancel requests if they want to, they can see which ones are in progress, all these kinds of things, okay, just from one interface. And then this area is most exciting to me. As we grow these service desks around campus, we're hoping that people will put FAQs into the system. So we have another project that we run on a monthly basis, working with help desk managers across campus. They meet once a month, and they're trying to share ideas on answers to frequently asked questions. So if I'm a customer and I type in the word WUSTL in here, it initially will search across every help desk in the system. And then if I say, well, I really don't want to read the answer from the business school, I really am looking more for the arts and sciences answer, I just filter it down to arts and sciences. I can see the question, I can show the answer, I can jump out to whatever links they give me, and then also I can rate how good that answer really was. Okay? And then lastly, I can see any messages if we have things like HR is down, or if some other big project is going on, like the data center work that goes on every summer. And then they can also go in here and view some information about their profile. So we're going to shift gears here in a minute and switch back over to your view of the system, and I want to answer some questions that you guys may have. But I want you to remember, at the end of the day, there is this overarching theme, this overarching strategy that we're trying to put in place, and that is to give customers a consistent way to submit requests across campus. Okay? Any questions about the customer interface before I shift gears over to the technical interface? No? So this is not going to be a training session, but we just want to point out some things that we're seeing since yesterday that we've gotten some very common questions from people about. We just want to answer those questions right now and then answer any other questions you might have to ask right now. And then I want to recognize some people who work on this project with me. So a couple things in here. We notice that people still are a little disoriented as they're navigating around the system as to what the difference is between my tickets and group tickets and search tickets are. So I just want to point those out really quickly. If you have a ticket assigned to you, it's going to show up in the My Tickets area, but it has to be assigned to you individually, okay? Your group ticket area is any ticket that your team has been assigned, okay? So if I'm in a group called Web Help Desk Admins, and someone has submitted tickets that request type, and that's tied to my group, it's going to show up here, okay? But if somebody moves that off to another group, then it won't show up in here anymore. and then I can go over here to search tickets and find basically any ticket in the system just by searching across key fields. And the one that is probably still a little confusing to people is this thing called request. That actually is the subject and the body of the message, okay? So if I type in the word test, then it's gonna shoot across all the subject and bodies of tickets in here that have the word test either in the subject line or the details section. Also in that area, you can search across the history. Okay, so if you have something like a department that shows up in the history that was changed, and you wanna know that, you can search across all tickets and find where the word department shows up. Also in here, you'll notice this is always using AND logic. And if you want to do OR logic, you just click on the OR. Another thing that's kind of confusing for folks in here is last name is actually the customer's last name, okay? And then the tech is the tech to which the ticket has been assigned. So you got all this in training, but we just want to remind you of a couple things here. The other one is that folks are still trying to find tickets, and when they go over to My Tickets and Group Tickets, of course, they only see the tickets that are assigned to them or assigned to their group. And so questions start to surface like, well, where are all the tickets that I created? Well, that will be under things like creator. Okay, so if we look in here, we look for a tech, like Michelle. We do a search. We can see all the tickets where she has created these tickets. Okay, we can then save that over here as a query. You can do this as a manager, you can do this as a technician. And once it's saved, once you're back over in My Tickets section, you'll notice the query is blank. I have no tickets assigned to me individually. But I'm one click away from just simply going ahead and running and seeing all the tickets that Michelle has created without having to leave that interface, okay? And then when I want to go back to the ones that are just assigned to me, I click on the blank and I'm back over here again. And these can be pretty powerful. You can write queries for any different thing. And so, you know, we're paying attention to some issues that we're having, and so we've written those queries. The upper half of the advanced search area is AND logic, so all these things have to match. But you can do things like OR logic. So it has to be at least this, but it can be any combination of these on the bottom half. So this was all in the training, but we just want to remind you that this stuff exists, okay? The last thing that we're seeing fairly consistently out here as an issue for folks, since we launched yesterday, is people are opening a ticket, then going to a different part of the system, opening a ticket over here, and not realizing that basically they still have this other ticket open over there. And so one of their buddies comes up to them and they say, hey, you got this ticket open. Well, they're looking at it in this view and they're saying, oh, okay, sorry, they get out of it. And they don't realize they still really have a ticket open. It's just open over here in that view. The system is very sticky, so it tries to remember what you did last. And so you may have a ticket opened up in one of those other views, okay? And so that will occasionally bite you. And another way you can tell that is, I'm getting old, apparently I'm 50 years old now, 3751. Since I turned 50, I can't see those kinds of things. So. Go over here for a minute and just show you this. 3751. Well, since I'm editing it, it's not going to show up. But if I was editing this as someone else, there would be a little pencil icon there. If you hover over the pencil icon, it'll tell you who's editing it, and you give them a call. Okay? So these are the most common ones since we heard in the last 24 hours. I'm sure there's going to be other ones. And I want to call it a success, but we're ways away from calling this successful at this point. I want to at least get a month into this before I feel really good at night. But we definitely got started off on the right foot yesterday. In large part, just some people I'm going to recognize here in a few minutes, we haven't yet seen performance issues, and that was a huge thing that we're trying to achieve in replacing Alteris or any stability issues. We have other things we're picking off, little oddities and bugs here and there. But right now, I've been very, very pleased with performance in the last 24 hours. I want to shift gears and recognize some people. Before I do that, I want to make sure if there's really a question you want to ask, that this thing's tripping you up on, you have a chance to ask that question. Are there any questions about the system right now?
Yes.
Yeah, no tickets get transferred. So you can work out about tiers for the next year to search tickets. Another project that will kick off probably in the November timeframe is I have to work with Harold Mack and Craig Schaefer to determine what tickets they actually want to pull in to this system. And so when Josh gathered the original requirements, no one felt like they needed tickets pulled in. As we actually went to launch date, they kind of have rethought that through and they want to pull some tickets in. So we're going to do that. It'll be at a later date and time. And you can still go into Altiris, reply to tickets, you can close tickets in Altiris, you just don't want to create any new tickets in Altiris. Any other questions?
Just a quick clarification. So if a ticket is assigned to an individual, will that ticket also show up in the group? Because I'm part of the group?
If you're a part of that group, that is your group tickets, right? But if it's assigned to, as long as it's still your ticket as your group, it'll still show up in your group tickets, even if it's assigned to an individual outside of your group.
So there's the STS group and then me as a tech, let's say. But if a ticket is assigned to me, will everybody else in STS also see my ticket in group tickets?
No.
Okay.
No. So if you're given a PCSS ticket because they want help from you,
right. You
individually will see the ticket in my tickets. But not everyone else in STS is going to see the ticket just because you are a member of their group.
Okay.
There's a big difference between this and Altiris in that regard.
Okay.
To get to STS, they would actually have to change the request type to a request type used by STS, and then it would show up in the group tickets. Yes?
Is the email functionality working now that it's launched?
Yes. You can email different addresses that the help desk have given us around campus, and it creates a ticket, it replies back to the person. I'm glad you asked that question, though. You do have to email from an @wustl or an @subdomain.wustl address. Whatever basically you have as a secondary address in HRMS or SIS will show up as a secondary address in here. You may get a call from a client who says, hey, I don't know why I can't see something. And so literally if you just search, bring that client up, you'll notice that everyone has a secondary address. It's pulling from whatever it is in HRMS or SIS. So it has to be seen in there. Okay. Also, if you just like playing around stuff, you can literally go over here and just like the query I showed you a minute ago, there's a little logged in client view. You can see right now, these people right now are logged into the system. So you can see which techs are logged into the system, which clients are logged into the system. I want to leave time to recognize my teammates, but we'll take one more question here.
We had a situation yesterday where we were getting into a ticket to update it and we got an alert that said somebody was already in the ticket,
yes.
Like you alluded to.
Yep.
What happens if both of those individuals are trying to update that ticket?
Yeah, so whoever saves last is going, their save is going to, I believe, the first person saves and gets out of it, and the next person, I think the person who saves last overwrites it. Okay. Is Valerie here? Can you write that one down for me and just test it when we get back upstairs and send a note back out? Unless you've already tested. I can't remember. I think that's when we tested it over the summer. I believe the last person who saves wins out. And so it's just a warning saying, hey, this other person has it in edit mode.
Yeah, and I was wondering because I asked Carol if he had the same warning. So the person that's currently in it doesn't get the warning. It's the new person that goes in.
You're exactly right. It's the new person. Has STS already tested this and you know the answer on it?
To my recollection, that is correct.
The last day wins?
Right, the last day.
Well, Valerie will test it for us and we can get a message. I just can't remember. One more question? Okay, one more.
It's not a question, it's more of a comment. But
okay.
Firefox is a browser choice.
Works across all browsers. We did extensive testing in Firefox, so that's the way I'll leave it. The company actually really probably prefers that you use Safari because they originally launched in 99 as a Mac-focused company. What we did all our testing with Firefox, the only browser we've seen any issues with is IE, and it's mostly in relation to formatting issues. But I every day, I use Chrome. That's actually the one I use all the time in it. But we haven't seen any inconsistencies between Chrome, Safari, or Firefox. IE gives us a bit of grief sometimes. Okay, as you guys know, and as we mentioned, a lot of teams right now are stretched very thin. It's good to be in technology because we are one of those segments where there's not a lot of unemployed. That's great, right? As managers like Hager, you're stuck now trying to compete with other people who are taking your staff, right? And so you still have to follow up all these projects, right? And so that can be a challenge. And so unlike any other manager, I have people who work for me who really have put in a lot of hours, and I want to recognize them. In addition to the steering committee, which once again was comprised of people across campus, even med school, Diane Gentile sat in on the steering committees, even though they knew they weren't going to use it. So they were huge in giving effort to this product to move forward. And as an example, is Ben Gears or Tony Balsamo here? Tony's here. So Tony, stand up. We'll applaud for Tony here as an example. Okay? I'll tell you why, Tony, because without leaders like Tony and Ben and Bob Guthrie, I don't think Guthrie's here, getting behind this kind of stuff, Ken Keller, this stuff doesn't happen, right? I can tell you, I've been here since 99, people don't typically around WashU want to get into a central system unless they're told to. And so it takes leaders like Tony saying, hey, we're going to do this because it benefits our customers, right? And so that's huge, actually. Also, the IDM team, if the IDM team could stand up for me, they do all of our authentication. It may seem like, who cares, Rick, right? I mean, they did their work a long time ago. All you gotta do is snap into it, right? Well, it doesn't quite work that way. As you guys know who implement stuff, it never works quite right, right? And so Ken Koch has this term called magic paint. He always tells me that, Rick, I got magic paint. And so he makes a lot of things happen. Ken's an amazing engineer. In fact, the fact that we're able to launch today is because Ken was able to hack their code and make it so that we would not get any authentication errors because they're still working out a bug for us. And then also people like Alex wrote some stuff for STS that made their move-in process much, much easier. So huge effort on that team's part. Josh Lawrence was my project manager until I stretched him so thin that I had to put him on two more projects. But Josh really led this effort, so please give Josh a round of applause. Valerie Gaston did all of our training and testing, so let's have Valerie. And for those folks who know Bernard, Bernard's this guy who does all of our security and institutional knowledge, and I just call him the fixer. If you need something fixed, ask Bernard. Bernard really showed me it's fixed. So Bernard, please stand up and meet. And then he's not here because I think he knew I was going to do this, but Mark Lopez says he has a dentist appointment today. But I think all of you guys have been heckled by Mark. He's been the guy who I've been leaning on really heavily to make sure all these settings get in place. Really a jack of all trades, and probably the hardest one, he keeps me on track. That's really hard. And so you can applaud for Mark, but he's not here. And then the final person, and I promise I'll be quiet, I know I'm taking more than 15 minutes, but that I want to recognize is Craig Schaefer. Craig Schaefer had this horrible role of having to stand up Altiris 3.5 years ago, and then he gets promoted to a different job, and I still come to him on a regular basis asking for help, right? And so we're all IS&T, and so of course he helps. And so he had to help me shut down Altiris. That means that really he did all the work, right? And then also he wrote this really cool app that allows all the app dev and systems and procedures people to do easy print screens into the system. Anybody in IS&T who will create a ticket and you want an easy way to do a print screen, if the ticket's only going to be shared within IS&T because it relies on SharePoint access, Craig Schaefer has an app that he wrote that will make your life easier in regards to this product. So please, Craig, stand up. So last thing I want to say is we're all stretched pretty thin. We're all told to do more with less money. And so because we went this path, because these folks who we just recognized put in the hours that they put in, we will save the university $367,000 in the next 3 years. We went with this application instead of the next one up. We had three vendors that we settled on. They all basically were the same. But of course, price is always a big significant difference, right? And so the next one up from us, literally over the next 3 years, if we adopted that app, it would cost the university another $367,000. So when you guys put in these hours, it really is for a reason. You have saved the university money. That's money that we can use in other ways. So give yourselves a round of applause. Any remaining questions? Oh, we got our arm way back there. Yes. Good. Excellent. Hopefully we can keep up the pace.
Thank you very much, Rick. STS actually had the privilege of piloting Web Help Desk prior to the go-live so that we could use it for move-in, and I can attest to its tremendous value and the amount of time that it saved everyone in STS during move-in and allowed us to provide really excellent customer service. So we're very thankful to Rick and his team for their effort on this. All right. So actually we have another video for you on this, and I'll let Steve just give a brief introduction while I get the video ready.
Hi, I'm Steve Westland. I'm an assistant director responsible for the SIS group. And I'm pleased to introduce a demonstration of a .NET web application that our group developed to support the College of Arts and Sciences new IQ curriculum. You may recall a decade ago that Jason Clevenger demonstrated the new Arts and Sciences Discovery curriculum at one of these staff meetings. In fact, I think it was right in this very room. Could I have a show of hands of anybody that remembers that demonstration? Do you recall that far? Okay, so there's some of us, all right. Well, what's cool about this is that a decade has gone by and technology has improved, and our ability to deliver a very effective system to help students plan their curriculum will be demonstrated here, I hope. So, but where's Jason? My colleague isn't here. He is at the University Registrar's meeting. So what we decided to do was have Jason be here in a virtual way. So he is going to be here via Adobe Captivate and do his presentation. Now there's three parts. He's going to introduce the idea of a curriculum through a PowerPoint. Then he's going to go into a demonstration of the old curriculum briefly. So those of you that didn't have the experience a decade ago, you'll get to see what the old curriculum looks like. And then you're going to see the new curriculum. And so look for the kind of the difference in how those same kinds of things are done in the 21st century. So I'm excited to be able to demonstrate this to you. So I think we'll go ahead and get started.
This is an overview of an SIS project that was commissioned by the College of Arts and Sciences for the new curriculum. As the title suggests, it was the culmination of several projects that spanned more than a decade. The first question you might have comes to our mission. This is an overview of an SIS project that was commissioned by the College of Arts and Sciences for their new curriculum. As the title suggests, it was the culmination of several projects that spanned more than a decade. The first question you might have is, what's a curriculum? The word derives from the Latin for race course and originally meant to suggest those obstacles you had to overcome for your education. It can refer to the set of all courses offered by the university, or it can refer to the general requirements a student must satisfy to earn the degree. To help students negotiate the new curriculum and to help administrators determine the requirement for that, ArtSci asked Computing and Communication for help with technical details. The end result was an application called the Planner. The original project team for that was Will Fritz, Jim Johnson, Jason Clevenger, and Mike Garrison. After a year and a half of effort, the product was delivered in the fall of 2001. In 1999, the college office began planning for a new curriculum. It would focus on both the breadth and depth of education for a student. The breadth requirement meant students had to take courses in sciences, arts, humanities, social sciences, writing, math, and cultural diversity. The depth of the education was ensured by the completion of four clusters, which were essentially mini minors of two or three classes focused on a central theme. In 2009, Arts and Sciences began a review of the new curriculum. The result was the creation of the IQ curriculum, or as we tended to call it, the new curriculum. The cluster concept was replaced by simpler integrations. There were changes in labels and changes in rules. The new curriculum applies to freshmen entering in the fall of 2012. Again, Arts and Sciences asked IS&T for help in upgrading the technology. The old Planner became a new application called PlanEd. This was led by a project team of Steve Westland, Jason Clevenger, Ted Hines, Tony Lau, and John Rutter. The new application was delivered in the spring of 2012. A key requirement for this new project was that it support the existing discovery curriculum and the plans for current students. Well over 50,000 plans had been created in the 9 years or 10 years since. We had to migrate business rules from Power Builder to SQL Server data objects. This consisted of about 40 object-oriented functions spread across 6 classes. We had to build a new .NET website to replace the Power Builder generated HTML. But we also had to integrate with existing administrative reporting interfaces that were not being replaced. Finally, we decided to create a new course listing site to provide information on both the Discovery and the IQ curricula. As exciting as it is to watch PowerPoint on video, we will move now to a demo of the older planner and the new Plan It. Afterwards, Steve Westland will be available to take any questions. Okay, we've opened up the older planet application for one of our test students, Dot Matrix. You can see it's a fairly old looking application, very contemporary for 1999 to year 2000. On the left hand side here are all of the degree requirements. These are the four areas, natural science, social science, language and architecture, and historical. Things like writing and quantitative analysis are also part of the requirements. What we're going to do is to go ahead and add a cluster. We'll open up Natural Sciences, hit Clusters. We have a tab here where we pick clusters. I can click a button called Browse Clusters, and we get a listing of all the possible clusters for Natural Sciences. We'll pick Calculus and Statistics. That gets added behind the scenes. We'll close this, and we now have Calculus and Statistics as one of our clusters. That cluster is made up of a series of courses. I click on the Pick Courses tab, take a second or two to load, and I can see the course options that I have. Some of these courses I've already taken, or the Dot Matrix has already taken. Here's one of them, Calculus 2, which is Math 132. It was taken in fall 2011 for 3 units, and Dot Matrix was given a grade of A-. Other courses have not been taken yet, so it seems like a good idea to check course that you've taken. So we pick that, and we need 2 courses. 2 courses are required for this cluster, so we'll also check probability and statistics. Go to the top and we click save. The application will reevaluate everything, and we can see now here's the cluster with my evaluation. There's a green circle for the Calculus 2 indicating that that requirement is completed. We have a yellow triangle here for the statistics course indicating that it's sufficient. What that means is that if Dot was to take that course and get a passing grade, it would meet the requirement. You can see over here on the left that now the cluster requirement has been met, and we have a yellow triangle for that. We can do a similar kind of thing for other requirements in the curriculum, simply by clicking on one of the areas and then adding courses. For example, under units, here are 4 courses that Dot has taken. The requirement is to take at least 8 units. So I will select Calculus 2, the stats, and then perhaps also Calculus 3. I click Save, and you should see now in just a second that the units get reevaluated, and it also is now sufficient. The green circle, again, Calculus 2 has been taken and passed with a grade of A-. And we have probability and statistics being taken currently in fall 2012. The statistics course is yet to be taken. So that's the basic idea of how the plan will work. You picked courses, you save them, you navigate around, and the goal was to get a sufficient plan. As you took the courses, the yellows would become blues, and then the blues would become green, and the plan would be satisfied. I've closed the planner and I've opened up Plan It. You can tell right away that it's a lot cleaner, newer interface. I'm still logged on as Dot Matrix, and I can select the plan that was started in the older planner. You can see on the left that it has that same kind of tree-based navigation. This was one of the requirements that ArtSci asked for. You can see also that the cluster and the units that we added in the planner are still there. But you can see that the interface is a lot cleaner. The tabs are gone, the dark gray is gone. You can see at a glance what the requirements are. There's the Calculus 2 that we picked. There's the probability and statistics we still have to do. If I click on textual, or let's do language and arts, I can add another cluster. So I can come here, select use a cluster, and then shop for a cluster in this library. I can click on a row and see what the cluster requirements are right away with a fold-out accordion style of view. For Chinese language and context, I need to pick at least two courses from this rather long list, and you're also encouraged to take one more course. But only two courses are required. I'm going to maybe skip this and scroll down a little bit further and take a look at this philosophy of language class. Here there are just two courses in it. That seems pretty straightforward. So I think I want to do that. I will make that choice, select philosophy of language. I go ahead and click the two courses that I'm interested in. And you can see I've already taken one of those courses, or Doc has already taken one of those courses. Introduction to Logic and Critical Analysis, Spring 2011, earned an A. So one course is done, one course still needs to be done. Basic idea is the same as it was in the older planner. I could go through and do choices for other requirements. For example, cultural diversity. I need to take one course in cultural diversity. There are three options here that I can select from that I've already taken. It shows when I took the course and what grade I've earned. So I'll go ahead and take Musics of the World here. That requirement is done. Let me do similar for the social differentiation. And again, I've taken a couple of courses. This is pretty typical. College of Arts and Sciences asks its students to really focus on the planner in their sophomore year, encourages them to shop around or look for courses in their freshman year without worrying too much about how they might fit in later on. So I'll go ahead and take Japanese Civilization here. And I can keep doing this same kind of thing. The hope is at the end of the process, you have a bunch of indicators for either sufficient, complete, or in progress. One other feature of the application is that you can use a major or a minor to satisfy one of your cluster requirements. So for example, I can preview possible majors in different departments that would meet the textual and historical studies requirement. If I want to, I can click on it for more detail. Here, what it's done is opened up information about that requirement in our undergraduate bulletin. If I'm interested in that, I can read through it, or I can go ahead and close that down. I will pick, for example, I will go ahead and pick the major in archaeology, and that will help satisfy that one requirement. The last thing I'd like to show you is the ability to search for information about clusters in a side-by-side way. That's a pretty cool feature when we developed it. Again, I'm opening up the cluster comparison window. Let's take a look at behavior and brain science. Pretty interesting. If I click on one of these courses, I can learn more about that course. And what happens is information about the course opens up here on the left-hand side, and information about the cluster opens up here on the right-hand side. And as I scroll through, I can look at courses in the cluster, for example, psychology of language, changes on the left, and if I can look over here on the left, I can see what clusters that course is in. So for example, I can say, well, behavior of brain and cognition is pretty cool, but minor languages might be more interesting. And I click on that, and that cluster opens up over here. So this allows a kind of deep in searching back and forth between courses and the clusters that those courses fit in. When I'm done, I can come back to my search results and make a choice. This concludes our talk about the ArtSign Curriculum Planner. Steve Wesselin is available to answer any questions you might have. Thank you very much.
Okay, so do any of you have any questions about the Curriculum Planner? I have a question. What does IQ stand for?
Intelligence quotient.
That's what I thought. IQ must be to make everybody really smart, or it's for smart people. But pardon?
Something inquiry?
Yes, integrative inquiry. So, and they kind of labeled it IQ, so kind of an interesting name. So you can see some similarities between the old and the new. What this demo didn't show you was the new IQ curriculum actually in action. Jason used the discovery curriculum that he started with the old system to continue with the new, just to kind of show you how they both function. A lot of the reason we had to redo it beside the technology replacement was to actually support all of the new rules that had to go into the new curriculum. So it's in production. It's been in production since the summer, and I think it's we're getting good reviews on it. So could anybody? Oh, Denise.
Steve, do you want to say something about the partners in the college office and in the office of the university registrar?
Yes. Well, our partners in the college office. We worked a lot with the college office to develop this. Trevor Billhorn was, and then Jennifer Romney really participated in this, and as well as Jill Fechtman in the university registrar's office did as well to help us get the requirements for this system and come up with testing. In fact, I was going to recognize anybody from our staff who participated in either curriculum. Could you stand up, please? Those of you on the SIS team, or if you were on the planner or the discovery curriculum. Okay, there's, okay. And also, let's see, is Jane Pack here? Okay, Jane is another person who worked with the college office. Denise, did I leave anybody out? Okay.
Actually, we're going to go ahead and take a quick 5-minute break to let everybody that might need to use the restroom and wants to grab another donut or some coffee, and we'll come right back. Turn back up at 11:20. Thanks very much. I would like to introduce our own Barb Braun, who's going to give us a little bit of a little update on how move-in went this year. Went very well. Here you go, Barb.
Well, how about those Cardinals? Yeah. 12, they don't sell hot dogs in Chicago in October. Ask Andy, he'll tell you. So I just want to give you a real quick update about move-in. And this past summer it was really, really great. One of the things, though, that we did to get ready a little early was some things that occurred over the summer. And as Rick said, we were pilots for Web Help Desk, and we love Web Help Desk. So those of you who are just getting in there now, you will be so thankful that Altiris is gone. But one of the things that we did come up with was a web page called Quick Help, where the students can go to a very easy interface and log a ticket into STS. We also, as you see over here, have a QR code that we put on the back of our student staff's t-shirts, and we also plastered them all over the labs and sent them to the schools so students can scan the code. It opens this up in a mobile-friendly version. They can fill out the ticket, and we get it inside Web Help Desk. So those things were some things that we did ahead of time to get ready for the 4,400 that came back on campus. Thankfully, we love Alex, and I know he's been recognized. Thank you so much for your help. We also have a Web Help Desk check-in app that was developed. And as you see here, our STS techs or STCs who are working can come into the help desk on their shift. They log into Web Help Desk using their WUSTL key, and this window opens up and it stays open on the check-in desk inside STS. A student will walk in, we ask them for their ID card, and we swipe the card. As you see here, we have installed a few card swipes. And immediately the application searches and finds the student. And information, just a little bit of information about the student. You see, this is Chris Hills from just a few years ago. It pulls up the picture of the student, and you notice right here, it's already created a Web Help Desk ticket. And we did this to make it a whole lot faster, because during move-in, you'll see in a minute about how many people that we actually dealt with at STS. So the ticket has already been created, but it is in a closed status so that we could record customer contacts, which is a lot of what we do during move-in, is just answering real quick questions. If we needed to take this ticket then and open it, we would click on Open Ticket, and it would bring in the actual full ticket and we could put the details in. Okay, so that just really saved us a lot of time. In the past, we would tally on a sheet of paper every time a student walked in the door. They weren't real good at tallying on the sheet of paper. We tried filling out little cards. We weren't real good about filling out cards. But we got card swipe devices, put them on iPads, out of the field and on iPhones, swiped ID cards, and we could record customer contacts that way. If a student comes in and they do not have their ID or they are uncomfortable with having to swipe their ID, we can get their WUSTL email address and click search, and again, we pull up the student record. Now, in this case, there is no open ticket, so that if we decide to then open a ticket for the student, we click the check-in button, and we go into the application for Web Help Desk and create the ticket there. Okay? We also have a very, very bright young man, Oliver, who is our student manager, who was working for Microsoft this summer, and John reached out to Oliver in his spare time and said, "Hey, Oliver, is there some way you could give us an iOS app that we could put this actually on an iPad or on an iPhone and do it in the field?" And he did. So we have an app that we can now carry around with the students can use or techs can use. And again, they can swipe the card or they can submit an email address and it opens up the Web Help Desk ticket while they're in the field. Our students are very untethered, so it's good that we can take the application to them. Okay, so pick a number between 1 and 1,401. We had over 1,400 customer contacts in those 4 days. And we logged those through Web Help Desk with card swipe. It was fantastic. No papers laying around, no sitting for 2 or 3 hours after the office closed and adding up tallies and tickets and cards and sorting. It was all done in the application. So many of you helped us do that and it helped us get ready for school. If you actually worked a remote help desk, would you stand for just a moment and let's give you all a round of applause? We couldn't have done it without you. Desks located all throughout the South 40, primarily in the freshman areas, and we cannot staff those with the few of us that are at STS, so we really do appreciate your help by helping us do that. So I'm going to just leave you with some basses and a little bit of music. If you are like a John Travolta fan and you want to tap.
You're tired of me. Oh, yes. For anybody who's interested, we have many leftover. These were freebies that we had for students when they moved in, and we have too many of them. They fly exceptionally well, as I'll demonstrate right now. Think fast part.
Or you can wear it as a hat. Or a bracelet.
So. So, Marcia, not to put you on the spot or anything, but you're up.
Actually, Bernard's going to start us off.
Oh, really? Okay. So we have for updates?
Sure.
To you, Bernard.
Thanks. Thank you guys for coming out today. Marcia kind of surprised me, told me at the last minute. She's like, "Yeah, but how do you want to do this?" I'm like, "Well, you know, probably top 100 people this week. Sure, no other folks will be doing that." I want to go with just part of this. Marcia's going to conclude it. I do want to say thanks to Rick and Josh and all the folks here with the Web Help Desk. Rick is always kind of, he's always there moving things forward, and we move this thing forward. And sometimes I sit in the back seat and just watch him go forward and take notes, and but he moved it forward, and so I appreciate it. And I'm probably one of the greatest fans of performance. Altirius has always been a performance issue for my group from the very onset. And Rick makes me know that from early on, we first picked Altirius.
I didn't ask him to say all that. Oh,
we'll finish up. We first picked Altirius, everybody went around the room. Andy was in the room, everybody went around the room, and everybody's like, "I like it. It's good." And I said, "It's slow." And there was that. So I really appreciate this Web Help Desk move. So a couple things you're going to talk about here.
Yeah, just the hierarchy.
Talk a little bit about training rooms, meeting rooms, and then Marcia talked about administrative changes, time off reminders, relocation, United Way, and the holiday party. For whatever reason, these training rooms get stuck to me. I've tried to shake them forever. In room 382, we're going to get some new PCs, long overdue. We'll get those taken care of probably by the end of the month, 1st of November. We're going to install deep freeze, which will allow the basically, what was happening is folks are uploading various things with these training PCs, and so we're going to get to the point that we basically freeze them and refresh them. They go back. You can do things while you're working on it, but eventually what will happen is all those things will be wiped away. Basically. So we bought this deep freeze software. Late evenings on the third Tuesday of each month, computers will thaw and perform Windows updates. Save files to an H drive. Files can be saved for multi-day classes. Instructor creates folders as needed. Instructors clean up folders after each class. That's training room 382. The other training room in the other building is training room A, scheduled for new computers and deep freeze, but not till next year. Here's the things to ask, some best practices, folks. Reserve the room prior to use. Don't just show up with the key and just have a meeting. Just look. If you change the trainer's PC, restore it to its preferred state. Nothing's more disenfranchising than to show up in that training room and it's not prepared for you to train, and you have to try to figure out and jump through hoops to make it work. Don't need to shut down the computers. Last day of the last day should reboot the computers, which will return it to a fresh state. Apps installed by the users will be removed. Files on the hard drive will be removed. We're almost done. Reiterate this, return to trainers. There's nothing more disenfranchising than that. Leave the PCs on. Store materials for multi-day classes on top of a filing cabinet. Turn off the overhead projector. Clean the whiteboard. Push chairs to the table. Remove trash. Remove anything that was brought into the room for training or meeting. Leave the room presentable and ready for the next group. And then, of course, return the key, which sometimes is an issue as well. And if it's after 5 o'clock and you don't like returning the key, then the next person shows up the next day and there's no key to the room. We've had that happen too, so we'll try to work through that and give some folks some keys. Is that the last one? West Campus Training Rooms 382 and A, request room reservation and cancellation to Angelia Piper, who's sitting at IS&T now. The other rooms you can actually reserve yourself, most of them, 413, 395, North Campus, 1631, and the project room. You can view the calendar and add the appointment yourself. You can do the reservations. On the second floor, they're all managed by the second floor receptions in regard to room reservations. And what you do is you email WashU West Campus Reception, so call 54381.
Is the first one a change, Bernard? Because I feel like I've reserved training room myself.
You have. You have special privileges. Magic, Ken's magic, but where you've gone, you A lot of folks run into problems with it, but probably a person who utilizes it to the capacity that you do you've been empowered to actually do so. So that's.
And that's why I asked you to do
it. And I'm done.
Okay, I'm going to talk about a few administration changes just to set the record straight. And we have some awesome people in our group who help support IS&T and do all the behind the scenes type of work. And so I thought I'd introduce them with some maybe key words that will help you remember who does what. So our newest addition to our staff is Angelia Piper. And if you would stand up, Angelia, so everybody can see you again. I know you were in the video. I think of Angelia, you should think of her as the helper, right? She is working over at West Campus. She's at the front desk. She will be taking care of scheduling all of your meetings. If you have large meetings, meetings are we setting up, how many, what are the size of them. And by having everybody go to one mailbox, we have all that information centrally. In the past, you would send emails to either Barbara or to Sherry or to me, and we really couldn't keep a good count on that. So if you have need for supplies or maybe the water is leaking from the roof over your head, then you should go talk to Angelia. Okay. The next thing I wanted to mention too is that because she schedules a lot of meetings, we would really like it if you would use a standard format for requesting those meetings. So when you do an email to Woo IS&T appointments, this is the standard layout that we would like you to use. This layout is out on SharePoint in a document under policies and procedures on shared documents. If you give us all of that type of information, we won't have to come back to you quite so many times. If you put it in this format instead of a bit here and a bit there and another piece of it at the end of the email, it's much better for us because then we can be sure that we're setting up the meeting that you really wanted and include the people that you need to have included. Okay, Sherry Hall, stand up please, Sherry. You all know Sherry, but I thought you and Sherry's what I think of as the caregiver. So she's taking care of all of us, especially new hires, getting them acclimated, people care, anything having to do with personnel issues or HR related questions, you should go to Sherry for. Anything with FMLA, you should go to Sherry for, and it would help if I hit the next button. So there's just a list of all the types of things, work that she does. I'm not gonna read through this list, but because you all know that she's around helping out with the new hires, helping out with FMLA, and with all of the activities that have to happen before we actually hire someone. Barbara, now Barbara is the spender. She has the fun job. She gets to spend all of the money that we have in our department because she's making all of the purchases. She's making sure you get your paychecks, that she's a very important person for you to get to know. She will pay out invoices, request checks, she'll register you for conferences, for training classes, help you with your travel reimbursements, and she's going to be assisting the business manager with other tracking needs. And our fourth person is Christy, and she's the bean counter, right? So if you can remember these key names, it might help you remember who to go to for certain questions. And as the bean counter, she's going to be making sure that all of the reporting is done, the budget is submitted every year, assisting the leadership with their questions and reports that they need, doing some sort of analysis as requested. So she will be also working closely with Barbara. All right, so I hope that helps you know who to go to if you have any kind of a question about day-to-day operational stuff, and if it didn't fall on any of those lists, then come see me. All right? The second topic I wanted to talk about is relocations. You may have heard some buzz about people being moved around within the department, and we thought we would just give you a heads up that there are going to be some moves made. You will see movers around, you will see some people in building cubicles.
we've been working on a plan to accommodate additional positions that we were granted to work on things like the undergraduate admission system. And so in order to do that, we are going to move Tim Redman and his group to the third floor. There's only one person on the third floor, that's Matt Arthur, who will go up to the fourth floor. There may be some people shuffled around on the third floor, and there will be some people shuffled around on the fourth floor. But that's all to make room for all of the additional positions that we have. So don't get too excited if you see people walking around with roller carts, you know, that's to move furniture. We have a lot of desks that will need to be moved, but you won't be asked to pick up any desks or do any of that. Okay, the movers will be here hopefully all on Monday. We're trying to coordinate that, and we're working with telephone services and PCSS to coordinate everything. We will try to have every workspace in cleaned before you move into it. So if you're moving into one that's old, you can trust that we will have had it cleaned. And we'll be starting pretty soon on this. So I am urging all of you who are moving to please start cleaning out your workspace and get rid of all the stuff that has been sitting around for a while that you don't really need. Okay. I had to throw a couple of administrative things in here, and sometimes we forget that there's a great resource out on the HR.wustl site, and it is the employee handbook. And I cannot urge you enough to make sure yourself familiar with that book, because it has a lot of policies in it, especially around time off. So I pulled out a couple of them that I just wanted to mention to you. When you want to take vacation, it's not a given. You should be requesting it from your supervisor, and then only after approval plan to take those days as vacation. If you are taking vacation, put it on your Outlook calendar as busy or out of the office. And if you also should be putting it on the IS&T vacation calendar that's out on the SharePoint site. Because a lot of people rely on that calendar to know, well, is so-and-so here today? And they go out and look on that calendar and look to see if you put your vacation on there. So please remember to do both of those things. If you are out of the office, you should also be setting your out-of-office email up, and you should be putting a voicemail message on your phone to let people know that you are not there, and always give them another person's name and number to contact in your absence. Also, a reminder that you don't want to wait till the last minute to plan to take your vacation. So if you have not taken any vacation, you should be planning that so you don't end up needing to take 4 weeks of vacation in June, because it won't happen, right? Time off reminders. This has to do with sick days, and I thought I'd bring this up just because we're heading into the flu season. And everyone's allowed up to 5 instances of a sick day without any kind of physician's statement. And an instance is any part of a day. So one whole day is one instance. Half a day is one instance. So you're allowed 5 instances unverified. But once you've taken those, you really need to get a doctor's statement, some kind of release from the doctor, bring that in so that your sick is verified, your sick time is verified. Also, technically, your sick time should not be used for staying home with another family member who's ill, taking dental appointments, doctor appointments, routine tests. Those are all considered to be vacation time, not sick time. I know you all are going, what? I never heard of that. Read the employee handbook, please. If you are going to be out sick, please contact your supervisor, and if you can't get a hold of the supervisor, you should also contact the front desk, Angelita Piper. Let her know that you're going to be out. She can email your group to let them know that you have called in, that you won't be in. It's really important that people know where you are. If you do not contact supervisors or within the first 2 days of your absence, that is considered grounds for dismissal. So be certain that you contact your supervisor and at West Campus, the front desk. Okay, the United Way campaign has been ongoing for about 3 or 4 weeks now. I just wanted to mention one thing. I'm not going to make a big push for United Way, although I personally believe in it. I am just going to mention that the last report we got, and I believe me, I get no reports other than the entire amount collected by the entire university. Okay? We do not get breakdowns by department. So they're getting very close to reaching their monetary goal. They are very far away from meeting their goal of having more people participate in the campaign. So if you have even considered making a $5 or $10 donation, I encourage you to do that. Go online and make that donation, because that counts towards our percentage of participation. Laurie Wilson, are you here?
She's not.
She didn't come down.
She's upstairs.
She's upstairs in operations. She's the lead operator in operations, and she's been selling snacks and out in the burster room, and she's also been doing the 50-50 raffle. So she's taken that upon herself to do that, to raise money for United Way. So you might want to participate in those things. Also, by the way, if you go out to the United Way site right now, you can't even see the main site, because they have this ad for purchasing raffle tickets for Cardinals tickets. So if you want to spend $10 and get in on the chance to win some Cardinals tickets for the games, go to that website. The last thing I have is the annual holiday party. And last year, Sherry chaired that group, and I've already sent a note out to all of the new hires letting them know that this is an annual tradition in IS&T. But Sherry's going to take it from here and tell you a little bit about how we're going to do it this year. Sherry?
Hello. So many of you remember last year's extravaganza, which was a great time, so hopefully we'll be able to recreate that again this year. Not the exact same thing, but get a new, fresh perspective on things with the new hires who are on this list that I'm about to read. Again, like Marcia said, I'll be leading and heading or planning the very first meeting, but then I'm going to kind of pass the torch on to that committee. So if you hear your name, can you stand up? And a round of applause for the folks that I'm about to mention. So the first person's Gwen Arthur, who started actually this week. All right. Angelia Piper, Jerry Rothler, Chris Freeland, Alexandra Nepperton, Stephen Wang, Christina Benedict, Daniel Oakes, Mary Kuppenhofer. It's Kuppenhofer, right?
Kuppenhofer, okay.
Chris Budge, Louis Kaskowitz, Nathan Litz, Gary Binney, Donna Peterson, David Linder, Brian Schuler, Satya Mumam, David Mitchell, Michael Rogaz, and David Smith. So again, a round of applause. So we hope to see you all here December 20th, 3:30. We have a couple of locations right now to reserve, but again, you'll hear more as we develop this. Thanks so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our program. Unless anyone has any questions for any of the presenters, or myself, well, I'm not sure what I would tell you. But, any other comments or anything that anybody wants to share real quick?
Thank Marcia for the donuts.
Oh, yes. And thank you, Marcia, for providing the donuts and the coffee.
Yes, yes, staff who could make it, they can watch this later. Is that right?
That is correct. Yep, so staff who were unable to attend because of their job responsibilities or other reasons will be able to view this, any portion of it, after the fact. Thanks very much, everyone.